Good morning. Let us start as usual from brief revision what was done on the previous lecture. So we introduced covariant transform that was done in rather general terms through some fiducial operator. That is generality which will not be actually used in that particular course, but it's good to have for the future. So the key property of the covariant transform is its intertwining property. It's intertwined the given representation, the representation which was used to build the covariant transform with the left regular representation on so we used some representation rho to for this covariant transform, and exactly this representation rho is intertwined with the left regular representation. In this way, covariant transform allow us to make a model for our representation rho as a sub-representation of the left regular representation. So left regular representation, in a sense, is universal representation, as a representation through the covariant transform became sub-representation of the left regular one. So the most common situation in the literature, and it's only a real covariant transform which we will be using in our course, this is for fiducial operator which is a linear functional on our vector space. So it's one dimensional operator which map our space to one dimensional space of scalars. And if we are working in a Hilbert space, such a linear functional by Ries representation theorem can be taken as a vector from the same Hilbert space, and linear functional is given by inner product. In this case, our covariant transform is defined by the equation 49. So equation 49 is the actual form of covariant transform used for our lectures. And covariant transform can be defined not only for our Heisenberg group, it's actually meaningful for almost any other group, and as Weyl transform, it's most used for the so-called affine group, AX plus B group. So covariant transform built for this group is the very popular in the signal processing and other engineering applications. So particular form which will be of interest for us is the covariant transform which applied to the used the Schrödinger representation in one dimensional space of function with one variable, and if it's used with the Gaussian as mother wavelet, we will obtain a formula which is known of as Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, or simply Bargmann transform. For the mother wavelet, there is a useful condition. The condition is that representation applied to this mother wavelet acts by means of certain character, and then for this character we can construct the corresponding covariant transform which acts trivially along the chosen subgroup, and as such we obtain the common construction known as Gilmer-Perelomov-Cogerant states. So in this case, covariant states or covariant transform, it is not parameterized by entire points of by all points of our group, but rather by some homogeneous space where we factorize group G with respect to this subgroup H tilde acting by characters. So in this case, a covariant transform which appears intertwine the representation rho with some other representation induced from the subgroup H tilde by means of character chi. So initially representation rho may be constructed in some different way. So it may be constructed as induced from one subgroup, but by means of covariance transform we can intertwine with representation induced from another subgroup. So it's interesting situation. So some representation indeed allow induction from different subgroup and different characters. In particular, for our construction of Fock-Siegel-Bargmann transform, we may drop action of the center, because center is acting by means of multiplication with scalars. Now we came to very useful operator, another operator which allow to obtain different form of induced representations. This is averaging. So averaging is a simply integration along a subgroup H with a character chi. So this integration along subgroup produce a kind of partial Fourier transform with respect to variables in subgroup H. And what we can immediately derive from this formula. So it need to be said some warning about meaning of this integral. So if we have here non-compact subgroup G, H or non-compact group G itself, that integral may not be always defined in plain terms. So it may be some divergences. It may be necessary to consider some special space of functions. So initially we define that integral for the nice space of continuous bounded function with compact support, when that integral shall be nicely defined for all subgroup H. But in many situations we need a larger space of function, and for a larger space of function that integral in plain term may be divergent, and so it's necessary to see some different definition, say in terms of the distributions or in term of in the weak sense. So some of that technique is required for the definition of that integral. So let's look for properties of this integral. Properties of this integral is as follows. So first, most important, what this integral has the covariance property which we required for induced representation. So if we will come back to the definition of the induced representation, when we asked what action from the right by subgroup H reduced to multiplication with a character. And so that integral exactly delivers the first property of averaging, is deliver as a space of function with this property on the group. Correspondingly, image space of this function is left invariant, because easier to verify what if we have a function averaged over a subgroup and we make a left shift. So it will be just averaging over the subgroup of the left shift of this function. Correspondingly, if we will restrict the left regular representation to the image space of the averaging operator, we again obtain intertwining operator, or we will obtain a representation which is induced by the corresponding character. So, okay, coming back, we defined the convolution operator for our functions on the group. So convolution operators on the group was defined by integration on the group with respect to invariant measure, and we said that L1 function make a convolution Banach algebra with respect to such a convolution on the group. Then space of functions which has this covariance property in stated in first item here is the corresponding right convolution ideal. That means if we will make a convolution with function K1 just from a group Banach algebra L1 and K2 from this covariance space of function, then convolution of K1 and K2 will be again in covariance space of function. Second property, A2 acts as the projection. So if we have a function which was already averaged and we try to average it again, we will just recover our function again. So that is the projection property for our averaging. And finally, for the representation row which we induced from particular character chi, if we will consider integrated representation. So integrated representation was defined in that identity 46. So we integrate function with corresponding kernel. So construction of integrated representation from function f will be exactly the same as the integrated representation from averaged function. So because representation is obtained by such an induction, so we get the corresponding relation between these two functions. So because averaging is a kind of projection, it's cut off particular sort of information out of function. So that mean that last relation, that last identity, actually to tell us that we may cut a similar amount of information from integrated representation. So not all parts of function f will contribute to integrated representation if our representation is induced by a particular character. So this is a property and they are stated in rather general terms. Let us see how averaging operator act on the Heisenberg group and the subgroups which we considered before. So for our group, Heisenberg group, we consider it collection of subgroups. So the first example will be just the center of the Heisenberg group and corresponding character. If we will make averaging, that means we integrate function over the character, over the center. So integration is done over the center, and the result is multiplied. The actually that function will not have any dependence after integration. Dependence from the central variable disappeared. So instead of that, we multiply by exponent of the central variable with the Planck constant. So we do come back to the that space of functions. Which was necessary for induced representation. So this is a particular example how that covariance property with respect to center appeared in the result of averaging over the central part of our group. Next example is the subgroup HX. So again, definition is here. So this is subgroup which consists of elements with only dependence on X part. So similarly, the averaging will just integrate over corresponding part of the subgroup and multiply by the character depending on this variable X. And if we will come to two-dimensional subgroup H prime X, which was done again before and corresponding character, just formula looks very similar structurally to what we had before. So again, integration over subgroup happen and multiplication by corresponding characters. The situation less trivial if we will come to the discrete subgroup, of the Heisenberg group. Recall, discrete subgroup have integers n and k in the x and y part, and s is arbitrary real. Then, if we will apply averaging with respect to this subgroup with a character here, for reasons which we spoke about when we induced representation from the discrete subgroup, character shall depend on the integer m, and result of the formula, resulting formula, will be rather non-trivial. That formula appeared from different sources, and so it has different names. Physicists may know it as exact transform, and it appeared in physical content as environment when it was studied behavior of a particle in periodic vector field. So this is how ZAP appeared to that. And mathematician may know that formula as Weyl-Brazin transform, and it's appeared from the study of number theory and theta function. So by Weyl and Brazin. So they so both sources lead to the same expression. So look again, let's analyze how that transform is working. We are taking a function which depends from one real variable from minus infinity to plus infinity. And what we are doing here, we make a kind of discrete Fourier transform. So we make a summation with a character here in order to obtain a function which now depend from a point on two-dimensional torus. So instead of function defining it on the real line, we get on one dimension, but non-compact infinite set, we get two-dimensional compact set, torus, by that transformation. And so that transformation has interesting property, and as we will see later, that is really a transformation which leads to the theta function constructed from the Gaussian. So here, discrete subgroup produce non-trivial example of the averaging. Now, considering averaging and convolution algebra, we may come back to the definition of induced representation. And for induced representation, we are considering the second scheme, which is based on the lifting. So we take a function from function defined on the homogeneous space, and we lift it to a function defined on the group. Such lifting produce a function having the covariance property as discussed before. But averaging act as projection to the space of function with such a property, and consequently averaging applied to a lifted function left such function unchanged. So averaging applied after lifting just equivalent to a lifting. Now if we have two functions defined on homogeneous space, we may lift them to the group and then consider convolution on the group. By the previous property we say that function which are having a variance property which are image of averaging so by the property 4 from this list of averaging, so by the property 4 convolution of two lifted function will be again in the space having covariant property. So these functions make an ideal, and correspondingly we may look on that convolution which is a function on the group as a function again lifted from the homogeneous space. And that leads to a definition of so-called twisted convolution. So twisted convolution, this is an operation on two functions defined on homogeneous space such that lifting act as the homomorphism of corresponding Banach algebras with respect to this operation. So it's lifting map the twisted convolution operation to usual convolution on the group. So for averaged operators we again have a similar relation. So if we have two functions on the group L1 and make averaging of their convolution, that is equivalent to the construction of averaging of both functions and then making the respective twisted convolution. So that operation of twisted convolution is closely related to the lifting induced representation, and in many cases it's a right substitution for the usual group convolution. So in particular for the Heisenberg group, if we will come back to the say Schrödinger model, and if we or Fock-Siegel-Bargmann model and look for corresponding expression, then the formula for Fock-Siegel-Bargmann and subgroup H, which is the center of the group, will take expression 60. And that expression 60 is actually explain the name, why it's called a twisted convolution. So if we will for a moment forget about this exponent in the expression, if we will drop it out, so the result, the rest of the integral, so the rest of the integral is just a usual convolution between function k1 and k2 on the Euclidean space. This is exactly the definition of convolution on two-dimensional plane. So but we not only have this convolution, we also have that exponential term in this place, and then it's produce that name twisted convolution, convolution with a twist. So we convolve two functions in Euclidean space, but their values are twisted according to the symplectic form on the two-dimensional plane. So that convolution operator is create certain algebra, twisted convolution creates certain algebra. As in any algebra we may define a commutator, so commutator as AB minus BA, and for our representations if we will use the formula 39, it's turn out what in representation of K1 and K2, integrated representation K1 and K2, we calculate the commutator in term of a twisted convolution. So instead of usual convolution of function, we use a twisted convolution. So if such a calculation will be done for the Heisenberg group and that expression 60, which we had before, then usual convolution on the Euclidean group, because Euclidean group is commutative, commutator of this convolution will be zero for a usual convolution. But we have here a twist, and when we subtract from the twisted convolution K1, K2, twisted convolution K2, K1, everything stay in place apart from that exponential factor where the symplectic form change its sign to the opposite. So we have here the exponent of some imaginary, purely imaginary number minus exponent of negative of this purely imaginary number. Then corresponding difference produce the sine function. Sine function from the symplectic form. That expression, the twisted commutator, which we obtained in this way, is known as the Moyle bracket. So this is integrated expression, integral, which define a commutator on classical observables. So if we will treat function k1 and k2 on the plane as being classical observables, so two-dimensional plane will be identified with the phase space of a physical system, then such Moyle bracket will be a quantization of Poisson bracket. So Moyle bracket integral produce corresponding replacement for quantum mechanics. So we will speak about quantum mechanical models a little bit in more details later. And finally, if we are speaking about Clairon transform, we want to define also the inverse map, and that inverse map is again based on the integrated representation. Actually, the inverse map called here contravariant transform. So contravariant transform is inverse for Clairon transform. This is actually the integrated representation of a function f on homogeneous space applied to the particular vector from our space, which is called the reconstructing vector. So in general, we obtain that formula 62, which is the reconstruction formula. So I already told that Clairon transform has that important intertwining property, and it's easy to verify in a similar manner what contravariant transform has the intertwining property of a similar type. It's here. So if we make a left shift of a function, then apply contravariant transform, that will result in the applying our representation rho to the contravariant transform of function. So, well, calculation is rather simple, so you may consider it as an exercise probably, but what is important, if we are considering what happened with the composition of the covariant and contravariant transform and what will be its intertwining properties when applying with representation rho of G, the make use the first intertwining property when it will be M composed with the left regular representation of G times covariant transform, and using the second intertwining property we just again obtain representation rho of G applied to contravariant transform composed with covariant transform. Now, if we will consider that composition of covariant and contravariant transform as a single operator, we will see what its intertwined representation rho with itself. If our representation is irreducible by the Schur lemma, it's known for irreducible representation, any intertwining operator with itself shall be a scalar multiple of the identity. So our conclusion will be what composition of contravariant transform and covariant transform is an identity operator times certain constant. So choosing properly is a Mother-Weigelet for covariant transform, and then reconstructing vector B for contravariant transform, we are able to get that constant C to be equal identity, so contravariant transform, constant C to be equal to 1, so composition of contravariant and covariant transform will be equal to identity operator. So, more generally, if our representation is not necessarily irreducible, there is a theorem 31 which describes the property of the composition. So that composition of contravariant and covariant transform will be a projection of B to the linear subspace in which B closed linear subspace, where reconstructing vector B naught is a cyclic vector. And so then we will be able to define a suitable projection into choosing proper reconstructing vector. We may define in this way projection to irreducible components of reducible representation. So we already identified quite a lot of object which either came from physics or have names of physicists. So it will be necessary now to, or it will be proper to introduce the language of quantum mechanics, as it shall be. And I would not like to touch in this course the controversial discussions of interpretation of quantum mechanics. How we shall understand wave function and what practically say two-slit experiment means in term of influence of observer on a quantum system and other things. So let's leave it outside of this course. So we just consider mathematical model which practically adopt by almost all formalisms in quantum mechanics. So we accept what a physical system is described by a particular state, which may be a function of time, so depending from a time that state may evolve somehow. But for fixed time, that state in quantum mechanics is presented by particular vector in the Hilbert space, and this vector shall have a unit norm. So that vectors with unit norm in the Hilbert space describe states of a physical system. When we are measuring certain quantities on a physical system, even in classical mechanics our measurements are not precise, they are done always with certain accuracy. And when we are doing certain measurement, we measure quantities which are known as observables. So something which can be observed or can be measured in practical sense. Things which cannot be measured, things which cannot be observed, is outside of physical discussion, so they are not covered by physical theory. And for the purpose of quantum mechanics, observables can be identified with the self-adjoint operators on the Hilbert space, which we choose to represent states of our physical system. So if we are doing a measurement, again, even in the classical sense, it's not precise, so if we will do like equivalent or the same measurement several times, each time we will obtain slightly different values, and actual quantities is typically associated with the expectation value, with average of several measurements in a row. And mathematical expression from quantum mechanical formalism say us what expectation value of a particular observable on a state observable A on a state phi will be given by this inner product. So we take inner product self-adjoint operator A phi, A applied to phi, and inner product with phi. So having such expectation value, we may be interested in the dispersion, so how big are differences between several consecutive measurements of the same quantity, and according to the standard probability theory statistics, as soon as we can measure expectation value of any observable, dispersion is just another observable, became another observable, and its evaluation is given by such a formula. So this is the norm of a vector where we subtract from operator A the average value A bar and apply it to the unit norm vector phi representing a state. So square of the norm, norm of this vector give us dispersion of the physical system. So this is just a formalism, standard formalism, which adopted by almost all interpretation of quantum mechanics. So we are dealing with that. Particular situation happen if our state phi is eigenvector for observable A, when it return the eigenvalue lambda, and if we will evaluate a dispersion on such a state, that norm here will be zero, so measuring dispersion on the eigenvalues, we obtain the zero dispersion. So that is again a consequence which follow from this previous definition. Now for the quantum mechanics in general terms defined on previous slide, we may come to the practical realization related with the Heisenberg group. So as a Hilbert space, we take collection, so this is a Schrödinger model in coordinate representation. We take Hilbert space to be L2 space of function on the real line, and we interpret the square of absolute value of this function as probability distribution, which give us coordinate of a particle. So to find probability of a particle to be discovered in particular interval, we just need to integrate the function f in over that integral. So in this case, we are, or in other term, we are looking for the representation of Hilbert space which diagonalize the coordinate observables. And then for the value of inner product on this space is given, of course, by integration over the real line. For the observables which return coordinate q of a quantum particle, the expectation value will be given by such an operator which is just multiplication by q of our distribution, probability distribution, and integration over the real line. So let us take a look how the particular operators from the Schrödinger representation which we defined before. So this is that identity 43 which we used in previous construction. So what will be the derived representation for corresponding subgroups? So we look what will be the representation of subgroup 0x0 when differentiated with respect to x. We will get the derived representation as was discussed before, and that give us the operator which is just derivative that give just what coordinate operator which is given by that formula is exactly derived representation of the vector field X from the Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group. Similarly, if we will in Schrödinger model look for the momentum observables, that momentum observable produce the dynamic which is a shift on the coordinates. So if we have some fixed momentum, then our system is translated proportionally over the time. So action of this operator when in derived form will give us derivative of our function. So it corresponds to the subgroup generated by y part of the Heisenberg group. Now if we will evaluate the corresponding commutator between coordinate and momentum, so that will be a commutator between these two differential between two derived representation which we considered before, but because both are derived representation of the Heisenberg of the Weyl algebra, Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group, so that commutator will be really the derived representation for the center of the subgroup. And again, coming back to this Schrödinger representation, easy to see what is the derived representation for the center. It's just multiplication by a scalar. So we will obtain the value of the commutator, which is given here. And what we obtained is exactly the Heisenberg commutator relation, the starting point with the quantum matrix approach of Heisenberg to the quantum mechanics. But our initial point was just illustration of the Schrödinger approach to quantum mechanics, where quantum mechanical system is described by a function of the real line. For dynamic, as we will see later, it will be given by the Schrödinger equation. So that illustration which we obtained here give a bridge between Schrödinger model and Heisenberg model for the quantum mechanics. So and Heisenberg group is just a bridge behind both representations. Probably it will be better to stop our lecture on this point. Any questions? Okay, don't forget to mark your attendance and hope to see you next week.